So the other day, I wanted a quick and easy project, something just relaxing that I could finish in a day. And even with the kiddos, I got this little guy done in one day. And filmed it too for y'all. There is a darling little bluebird on it. It is filled with lavender. It smells divine. And to fill in the bluebird using shadow room embroidery, there's a little bit of a trick that I will show you how to do in this video. The embroidery file is available for download on my website, and I also have an entire kit that contains all the supplies you need. So first I took the two pieces of fabric and gave them an ironing. This fabric is Spechler Vogel Satin Batiste. It is one of my absolute favorite heirloom quality fabrics, and I do think there is a right and a wrong side to this fabric. You'll see that the right side has a bit more sheen and is a little bit smoother on the weave. So I put the embroidery motif under the fabric and use a heat activated pen to trace around the lines. Whether you want to use a heat activated pen or a water soluble pen, that is entirely up to you. I much prefer the heat activated one, but to each their own. When I'm done with the tracing, I load my fabric into an embroidery hoop with a 6-inch diameter. This part is fairly important, and many mistakes can be avoided by setting yourself up for success here. For starters, slightly tighten the hoops together and then begin to pull your fabric taut. It will be a back and forth dance of pulling your fabric, tightening your hoop, pulling your fabric, and tightening your hoop until everything is drawn taut. Also, and this is very important, you only want to pull in the direction of the straight and cross grains. Do not pull with the bias of your fabric, or you can distort your fabric out of whack. So for all the embroidery on this motif, I am using only one strand of floche. Yes, that is floche and not floss. So I started by embroidering the little bluebird. And there are many different ways you can slice this cake, but here is the route that I took. I tied a knot at the end of the strand and began at the top of that top tail feather. The whole idea of shadowwork embroidery is that you alternate the backwards running stitch to fill in a shape. I know, it may look really pretty and impressive, but it's also quite simple. So I take a stitch on one side of the tail feather, and then I go to the other side of the tail feather, and I keep alternating until I get to a stopping point, and I will explain what a stopping point looks like in a second. While you are doing those alternating backwards running stitches, the goal is to keep the stitches on each side more or less in line with each other. So if you are going around a curve, you will have to slightly lengthen the stitches around the outside of the curve and slightly shorten the stitches on the inside of the curve, since the inside curve has a shorter distance than the outside curve, and this keeps your stitches even with each other. So at the end of this tail feather, we come to our first stopping point. And it's a stopping point since I have no more stitches to go on that bottom, right? I'm just out of a line. So now I move down to the lower tail feather and I repeat the same alternating backwards running stitch until I get to the end of that tail feather. Since I still have some length on my strand of floche, I send my needle back through the underside of my shadow work, like underneath those little strands that are going crisscrossing, and I pick up the lowest part of the lower body. Sending it through the underside of the shadow work helps keep the wrong side of the embroidery looking neater. And this may not be a priority for you. Honestly, it was not a priority for me for the longest time either. But over the last couple of years, I strive to keep things as neat as I can. But anywho, I keep doing the alternating backwards running stitch as I make my way from the lowest part of the lower body until I run out of floche. So to tie off, I go through a few of the underside strands, and I go through these same underside strands again to create a loop. And then I wrap my needle around this loop twice. You could only wrap once, and often I only wrap once, but I just felt like doing it twice. So finally, I send my needle back under those threads again to keep that tail neat, and then I cut off that strand. Next, I work on that lower wing. You could absolutely start at the bottom of this wing, like at the little point, you know, and you may find that easier, but I start at the top of the wing a little ways down, and I am moving a little ways down from the top of the wing since the top is so strongly curved that it doesn't present a good alternating situation. So I make my way down to the point of the wing, You know, just doing that backwards running stitch, alternating from one side to the next. And then I slide my needle behind my stitches on the wrong side of the work so I can finish at the top of the wing. And I alternate until the curve becomes too tight. When curves become too tight to alternate, then just simply do the backwards stitch, the backwards running stitch, to complete the outline. There's no more alternating needing. It's just too tight to alternate, you know? I hope that makes sense. I take my needle across the way to work on the top of the wing. This is fairly straightforward at this point, just alternating until the entire wing is filled in, and then tie off your strand if applicable. Finally, I move on to the head, beginning at the bottom of the head, alternating my way up, and once the curve gets too tight at the top to alternate, then again, simply do the backwards running stitch to complete the outline. Now we are almost to the tricky part of the little body. There's a tiny space here where you have the ability to alternate your stitches a bit, but you're going to get to a stopping point fairly quickly. So how do you get around this? Well, you just make it work. Fake it until you make it, right? So flip the work over and use the existing framework of the stitches to complete your weaving. I like to pierce the end of the existing strand so the floche that I'm weaving in doesn't slide around. It may not look super pretty on the underside, but once you turn it around to the right side, it blends right in. And there you go, we have a filled in, shadow work embroidered bluebird. Isn't that pretty? So now on to the flowers. To do the center of the flowers, I use a French knot out of the yellow color. I tied a knot at the end of the strand, set my needle up, and then wrapped my thread around the needle twice. At this point, make sure to pull the thread taut around your needle. You should see a neat little French knot forming, but sometimes the knot doesn't always come together as it should. And you will know what I'm talking about if that's happening to you. And if that happens, you should take your needle out and redo those wraps again and pull her tight. If it does not look like a neat little knot when you pull tight, it's not going to magically get any better once you send your needle through. So then I use the lighter of the two pinks to do the petals on the top flower. These petals are simply done with the lazy daisy stitch. And to do this, I put a knot at the bottom of my strand and I send my needle to the right side of my work at the bottom of the petal. Then I send my needle back downwards a few threads away from this entry point. Really, you could have gone right down into the same hole, or you could space it out a little further under what you're seeing on me do on the video. And this is kind of a personal preference thing, and it will result in different looks to your lazy daisy. So you can just play around with it and have some fun. Regardless, you'll come at the end of the petal, and this is creating a loop. Your needle is coming up on the inside of the loop, and once the loop is laying flat on your fabric, you'll secure the lazy daisy down by sending your needle to the outside of the loop to the wrong side of your work. Makes sense? Here, watch it again. Come up to the end of the petal, go down on the end of the petal, and now you're gonna come up on the inside of the loop, pull until the loop lays flat, and secure that down by sending your needle to the outside of the loop. And I just continue to make the lazy daisies in this manner, just using the applicable color as listed on the embroidery motif. So finally, we move on to those stems. I'm going to use the stem stitch. Haha, you get it? Because we're doing stems. Anywho, so I knot my thread and bring my needle up at the top of the stem. And I make a stitch, and I keep my thread below my needle. The thread stays below your needle for the stem stitch. So I come up kind of midway along the first stitch, and once again, I take a stitch while keeping my thread below my needle. And I continue in this manner for the entire length of that stem. I work all the stems in the same manner. I'm always keeping the thread below my needle on the side that makes the curve like concave up. Kind of like a little smiley face. This stacks the stitches on top of each other so they have a smooth, fluid appearance. And we are almost done at this point. So I take one strand of that brown color to do the little beak. I'm applying 3 stitches to the top of the beak as well as 3 stitches on the bottom of the beak. And finally, I take one strand of the black to do 1 French eye for the knot. I wrap this once and there you go, an adorable little eye. It's crazy how you can do the entire shadow work, but one simple French knot really sets the entire motif off, right? Now this is optional, but I did some shading around the bird's body. This is the stem stitch again, and at one point I had 3 curves on the bottom wing, but I decided that that was too much for a motif of this size, so just ignore that on my video, and I did update it on the embroidery file. So at this point, we are almost done. Seriously, you are so close to having a gorgeous lavender filled sachet. Is that how you say this? I hope so. Anywho, so you put the 2 pieces of fabric right size together. You can pin it in place if that's helpful for you. And I'm able to see the heat activated pin marks through my fabric. So I just use those as a guide to sew from the bottom of the leaving a gap until you get to a corner. Place your needle down and turn that corner to continue sewing. Of course, stopping a few inches from the starting point on the bottom so you will have a gap to, one, turn it right sides out, but also to put the lavender in. Now you can give everything a really good ironing, trim up the seam allowances down to about, half an inch, quarter of an inch, and give those corners a trim. Then flip the entire little sachet right sides out through that gap. Then I took this little pointer tool to press out the corners into a nice neat point. And I gave everything a really good ironing. This is the last time that you will be able to iron everything flat since we're about to put some lavender in her. So next, I rolled up a piece of paper, this is just computer paper, and I pinned it in place using a sewing pin because I didn't know where my tape was, to make a little funnel. And then I just used that to pour the lavender into the little sachet. I kind of gave the sachet funnel combo a little bit of a shake and the lavender went right into place. From there, I used 50 weight DMC thread to hand sew the gap closed. To do this, I came up a little ways away from the start of the gap so my thread's tail would be hidden. Then I made a loop and went through that loop twice to tie on. Once my thread was secure, I used the ladder stitch to close the gap. This is an invisible stitch where you take a little bite, go straight up, and then take another little bite. And you go straight down and you just continue that process. The key is to keep the entry and exit points in line with each other. And then when you pull your thread closed, the stitches just disappear. Isn't that lovely? Then I tie off using the same loop method, going around the loop twice and then sending my needle a little ways away from the point so I can hide my tail. And there you have it, a relaxing little project ready to smile back at you from your sewing room, inside a dresser drawer, wherever would bring a smile to your face. So you want to dive into more shadowwork embroidery? Check out this shadowwork dress, or maybe you would be interested in some shadow smocking. So much fun. Anywho, I hope this video was helpful. If you have any questions, please put them down in the comments below and I will do my best to answer them. And as always, I appreciate y'all for watching and I hope to catch y'all next time.